subscribe to Factly and hit the bell icon for updates.
भैया मेरा वोटर आईडी करा
लैंड रजिस्ट्रेशन करवा दो
मेरा स्कॉलरशिप
फाइल माय आईटीआर
दूसरा फॉर्म लेके आ
रूल पता है क्या
स्टेशन कहाँ है
बाद में आओ टाइम लगेगा
लंच के बाद
इज देयर अ सिंपल वे टू अंडरस्टैंड गवर्नमेंट रूल्स
Hello everyone and welcome back to Decode. Today's episode is about election expenditure by political parties, the only thing costlier than an Ambani family wedding. Our elections have been growing in scale since the first elections. Along with that, election expenditure by political parties has also been increasing, but at a much higher rate. A lot of people seem to think that this role of money in elections is eroding democracy. To discuss this topic, we have with us today Rakesh, our in-house expert. Hello, Rakesh.
Hi, Ayla.
How are you feeling about the 2019 elections?
Very excited. This is once a five-year opportunity, and as the Election Commission calls it, it's a Mahatyohar of the country. Yeah, really excited.
Yeah. So the 2014 elections received the highest polling percentage.
True.
But what a lot of people don't know is that it also received the highest amount of election expenditure by parties. What do you think will happen in 2019?
So like you said, in 2014, we had 66.3%, the highest ever Lok Sabha voting percentage.
Mm-hmm.
In 2019, like we said in one of our earlier episodes, the target is 75. So target 75. But while that is encouraging, the depressing part is that in 2014, according to the estimates of Center for Media Studies, the total election expenditure was around 35,000 crores. And in 2019, I'm sure it could be easily twice that amount.
Yeah.
What money does is vitiates the free and fair atmosphere. So I'm really worried about this money part.
So let me ask you, generally elections means a lot of marketing and campaigning by the candidates to reach out to the people, which means organizing meetings and meeting people, which would take expenditure, right? So why is there negative connotation about election expenditures?
The negative connotation is for a different reason, not for the reason that you're just saying. For instance, even for a college election or a university election, where there are hardly 1,000 people to reach out, people spend money and money is needed to reach out in this age. Now, if you look at the average Lok Sabha constituents in this country, so the average electorate size is around 15 lakhs and it consists of around 7 assembly constituencies. So it's a large geographical area and population. To reach so many people, it needs money. There's no doubt about it. To tell, if I'm the contestant, to tell people that this is my policy, why do you have to vote for me? We're hardly talking about 5 rupees per voter if you take the official limit expenditure. But why is there a negative connotation? Because from where, you know, from where we started in terms of telling people who I am, it has come to manipulating people with money. So people with a lot of money try to manipulate, bribe voters. So in some cases, the expenditure goes to as high as 30 crores, 40 crores per constituency. And it is your money and my money that is going in. You know, this particular individual who spent 40 crores will not stop there. He'll obviously try to get back his money post-election if he gets elected. So in a way, what is happening this in the spiral cycle is, in a way, eroding democracy. Tomorrow it will have an effect of effect on governance. It will lead to corruption.
Yeah, but don't you think setting a limit on election expenditure is limiting someone's freedom? I mean, we all spend whatever our capability is, right?
I would agree with you if it was someone else's private life. Yes, nobody has any right to put a limit on how much one can spend in their private life. But what we are talking about here is somebody is contesting for a public office, God forbid, you know, he's going to sit in the parliament making laws. So imagine, you know, if two people were fighting a case and one of them is trying to bribe a judge by giving gifts, you know, that is not acceptable.
Yeah.
So if that is not acceptable, even here, bribing voters, spending as much as you want is not acceptable because our judges are people. If multiple people are contesting, all of them should have it's free and fair process. So I think it is valid as long as you're talking about the public running for public office.
I actually happen to completely agree with you because we were also surprised to find that the Election Commission of India only spends 50 rupees per person to conduct the elections while the parties are spending so much more money.
True.
The total expenditure was equal to or less than 10 crore rupees each for the first three general elections. The expenditure of the last general election in 2014 3,870 crores, which is 50 rupees per person, was three times more than the expenditure incurred for the 15th general election in 2009. So, keeping all this in mind, the number you quoted earlier, 35,000 crores, which translates to 65 crores per Lok Sabha seat, that's some crazy amount of money. Where do they get it from? I'm guessing it's not their personal money, right?
Obviously not. In very few cases, it will be personal money of individuals, hard-earned personal money. But in most cases, it will be, you know, illegal so-called black money, which is unaccounted and earned through dubious means. In few other cases, it could be donations given by individuals, corporates, trusts to parties or individuals.
Okay, so let's start with individuals because we are the ones casting the vote.
Yes.
Is there a procedure through which we can donate money to the political parties, or can we just walk into a party office with a suitcase full of cash like filmy style?
Frankly speaking, the answer is both yes or no, but that will land you in trouble. You know, all that suitcase full of money, it happens in films, but in real life, that will be treated as black money.
Okay, can you elaborate on this a little more?
Yeah, if you look at the forms of donations, let's start with the forms of donations.
Okay.
If you start with cash, there is a limit on how much cash can one donate. So an individual cannot donate an amount of more than 2,000 in cash. Earlier it was 20,000, the limit has been revised to 2,000. So you can't, if you have to give more than 2,000 or donate more than 2,000 to a political party, it has to be through DD, check, you know, electronic means, or something known as electoral bond. Then secondly, what happens is if somebody is donating more than 20,000, so as per the rules, as per the Representation of People's Act, the political party has to report the donor's name to the election commission. So if it is less than 20,000, you don't need to do that. And recently, the government has also introduced something known as electoral bonds, you know, which they say is to enhance transparency.
Okay, so it sounds like there are a lot of measures being implemented to improve transparency. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, it is only like you said, sounds like, you know,
okay.
Political parties and parties in power are way more smarter than us.
Mm-hmm.
So let's look at the loopholes of each of the forms. One with cash, for instance, if somebody is giving me 1 lakh rupees and I can simply divide it into multiple chunks of, you know, 50 chunks of 2,000 each. So I can still accept 1 lakh in cash. Your earlier example of suitcase, you know, the entire suitcase can be converted into chunks of 2,000 and it becomes legal. Secondly, the problem with 20,000 is, again, only if it's more than 20,000, you'll have to disclose the name. And thirdly, the bigger problem is with something known as the electoral bonds, which the government is saying is to enhance transparency. Here it's the opposite. So only the people who are buying the electoral bond will know. Only the people who are getting this electoral bond, I mean the political parties, will know. But people like you and me, the ordinary citizens, will not know anything about who is giving, who is buying, who is getting it. So it is complete opaqueness.
Yeah, I've actually heard about a lot of resistance from the civil society towards the electoral bonds. Can you explain a little more about what these electoral bonds are and what they do?
The finance minister, Mr. Arun Jaitley, in 2017-18, while he was presenting his budget, he said, you know, we need to do more for transparency in political funding and, you know, all these high fund awards, and said we are introducing electoral bonds in that direction. The scheme started implementation in 2018. The electoral bond is issued in the nature of a promissory note, which shall be a bearer banking instrument. In other words, it neither carries the name of the buyer nor the payee. Anybody who holds the bond becomes the owner of the bond. Anybody can purchase an electoral bond, like an individual citizen, a company, an association of persons, etc. The bonds will be available in the denomination of 1,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, 10 lakh rupees and 1 crore. These bonds have to be bought from specialized designated SBI branches across the country, and only 29 branches across the country are designated to do this. In other words, most state capitals have a branch selling these bonds. And you cannot buy these bonds on the day of your liking. The government will decide on which days these bonds will be on sale. For instance, for the upcoming 2019 elections, electoral bonds will be available on sale for 45 days in the months of March, April and May. And secondly, smaller political parties and newer political parties are at a greater disadvantage because they cannot take advantage of electoral bonds. For any party to get electoral bonds, they have to satisfy two conditions. One is they should be registered under Section 29A of the Representation of People's Act, and they should have got a minimum of at least 1% of the vote in the previous elections to the Assembly or the Lok Sabha. In other words, smaller parties are at a disadvantage. And then the electoral bond, once bought, has to be encashed within 15 days. If you look at the numbers, till January 2019, electoral bonds worth more than 1400 crores were bought, and more than 99% of these bonds were sold in the denomination of 10 lakh and 1 crore, meaning most of these bonds were bought by corporates and not by individual citizens.
Are you serious? People don't want to mention their names even after giving so much money? I mean, I know people who give like 500 rupees temple donation and want their name in capital letters.
That's a different story, you know. We have this typical attention seeking disorder that comes there, but here, no. we need to understand why are they doing this. So there are people who donate crores of rupees through electoral bonds, through other means, but don't want their name to be revealed, mm-hmm. precisely because this could be unaccounted money, illegal money earned through dubious means. Secondly, these are people who might be expecting favors from the government. So if people come to know who has donated, potentially if there is a quid pro quo tomorrow and people will get to know, okay, this particular person or corporate has donated and which is why the government is giving. So there is very good reason for them to hide their names.
So quid pro quo is mostly helpful for businesses, right?
Yeah, largely businesses, but even individuals. For instance, you know, if somebody is dependent on a government approval or you know, some government scheme to run his business. It is both individuals and businesses, but largely, like you said, it is businesses. Yes.
So, are there any rules that are more stringent for these corporate groups because they have a stake in this?
Ideally, they should be, but you know, as the rules stand. So, originally, what was proposed in the rules and what stands is any business, you know, just can't simply go and donate money to political parties. They have to be in business they have to be running operations for at least 3 years. Mm. Then came profit making. I mean, a loss making company cannot donate. So only a company that is profit making, and it was the earlier limit was 5% of the average profit of the last 3 years. Then it was later increased to 7.5%. And you won't believe, the current government has done away with all these limits. So now, believe it or not, any company that can be just set up, you need not be in operation for 3 years. You can set it up today, go donate your entire amount, you know, whatever you have in your corporation to a political party. The rules are such now. So all these have been abandoned by the current government.
From what you are saying, doesn't it mean that anyone can set up a shell company and donate to political parties?
Yeah, like I said earlier, it is completely possible. So somebody can just set up a company just for the purpose of donating it to political parties, set it up today, you know, transfer all illegal cash or money, tomorrow transfer it to political parties and close it down. It's absolutely possible. We will not even know who they are donating to, because with the anonymous electoral bonds, it's going to get even worse. Hmm.
But wait, shouldn't these companies have to reveal their donations in their balance sheet, income tax returns, profit loss statements somewhere?
The transactions will be there, but not the recipient's name. So with electoral bonds, for instance, you know, what the government says, it provides complete anonymity. So the recipient's name will not be there. So in other words, while the balance sheet will have, they gave 2 crores, 3 crores, we won't know who they gave it to. So it will be very, very difficult to backtrack who they gave it to and establish any quid pro quo if there is any. And secondly, let us remember that who are benefiting from these electoral bonds? Mm-hmm. It could be the government in power mostly. So why will the government in power antagonize somebody who has donated money to them? Mm-hmm. So as long as government wants it, it will not happen. Mm-hmm. But if the income tax department or anybody wants to swing into action, they can. But like I said, government is controlling them.
Yeah. It looks like the corporates have hit the jackpot, right? It can't get any better for them.
Yeah, not just this. In fact, you're missing one more point. Let me tell you. All the donations that are given by corporates or individuals to political parties are, let's underline, 100% tax exempt. Just imagine, you know, if you and me, if we donate to old age homes or orphanages, we get 50% tax exemption. We are doing it for a noble cause. We feel for it. But with political parties, whether it's an individual or a corporate, they get 100% tax exemption, like a non-profit.
Yeah.
See, you know, non-profit are set up for a purpose. They're not profit making, but they're for a noble cause. Even political parties, theoretically, are non-profit because they're not set up to make profit, but they're treated differently. You get 50% here, but you get 100% here. That's the difference.
So, talking about NGOs, can a group of individuals like religious groups or NGOs donate to political parties?
Earlier, it was not possible, but now with electoral bonds, it is absolutely possible, because in the electoral bond scheme, it is said association of persons. So, it could be any trust, any NGO, any religious trust. In fact, a few years ago, electoral trusts were specially formed. So, there was a law which said there will be electoral trusts. Only their only purpose is to donate it to political parties. Now, why these trusts come into picture? They're more like a layered approach again to give anonymity to the donor. Mm-hmm. So, the corporates give it to the electoral trusts. Electoral trusts pool all that money and then they give it to the political parties. So, in a way, we will not know which corporate is directly giving to which party, because there is a layer of electoral trusts in between. In fact, BJP was the recipient of 86% of electoral trust fund in 2017-18. So, this is another layer of anonymity that we are dealing with.
Okay. Let's go to the final kind of donor that you were talking about, foreign entities. Why is this allowed? I mean, especially after we've seen how Russia tried to interfere in the United States, why is it still allowed in India?
Not just Russia, I think, you know, now there is a case going on, not just Russia, United States, some Western countries do try to influence elections everywhere. In a technology and globalized world, this is inevitable. We can't avoid that. But coming to the foreign donations part, there is an interesting backstory to it. Theoretically speaking, you know, foreign companies or foreign entities cannot donate to political parties because there is a legitimate fear that they can influence policy, which is not in the interest of the nation. But the tricky part is, what is foreign? The definition itself is tricky. If you go to the backstory, the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act of 1976 was enacted by the Parliament for regulating the foreign contribution given to political parties, NGOs, institutions, etc. Between 2004 and 2009, donations were made by Vedanta subsidiaries. Vedanta is a foreign company. Its Indian subsidiary donated to both the Indian National Congress and the BJP. In 2010, Foreign Contribution Regulation Act of 1976 was repealed and it was replaced by Foreign Contribution Regulation Act of 2010. In 2013, a former bureaucrat went to the Delhi High Court asserting that foreign funding received by both the BJP and the Indian National Congress is violating the Act of 1976. Special leave petitions were filed against the Delhi High Court judgment because the High Court said both parties are guilty and action has to be taken. So the government of the day, in a knee-jerk reaction in 2016, made a retrospective alteration in the definition of foreign company by amending the FCRA 2010 Act to protect the key beneficiary, which is both the BJP and the Congress. The amendment stands something like this. So today, any entity where there is a foreign investment of more than 50% theoretically cannot donate to political parties. But the amendment was made in such a way, now the donation will depend on the amount of foreign investment allowed in that specific sector. So for instance, in a specific sector, foreign investment is allowed up to 70%. Then even if a foreign company has 70% stake in it, it will not be treated as a foreign company, and all the money donated by it to political parties is perfectly valid. So the Delhi High Court again said both are guilty, they have to be, action has to be taken on both BJP and the Congress. So again in 2018, retrospectively, the government amended the act saying any donation that was taken from 1976 is valid. So in a way, parties have been guilty, but no action is being taken because the government has retrospectively amended the act of taking money from foreign companies.
Got it. So to summarize, black money can still come through using chunks of 2000 rupees and completely no transparency if electoral bonds are used.
Yes, that's the unfortunate truth.
It looks like there are a lot of loopholes on the source side, but what about the destination side? Are there any rules imposed on the election spending of the parties?
There is absolutely no limit on how much parties can spend. The only limit is on candidates. So if you are a contesting candidate, the limits vary from state to state. Currently for Lok Sabha, it is between 54 and 70 lakhs per constituency. For assembly, it is between 20 and 30 lakhs. Please remember, this limit is only for the candidate and not for the party.
So it means parties can spend as much as they want, as long as it's not an individual candidate. But isn't it true that most of us vote for the party and the symbol and not the candidate?
That is true, you know, which is why this rule has to go. This is not a fair rule, because any party that is in power and can spend more, can spend as much as they want. Secondly, the rules also say, so every party designates a few people as star campaigners. So for instance, the Prime Minister, you know, goes to every part of the country for campaigning for his party. Similarly, other major leaders of other parties. So these people's expenses are also not counted into the candidate's expenditure. So for instance, they travel to a place called Hyderabad and they campaign for a candidate of Hyderabad. Their travel expenses, etc., are not counted into the candidate's expenditure. And secondly, the candidate's expenditure limit, if it is 70 lakhs for instance, is counted from the day of his nomination till the last day of the result, which is about 3 to 4 weeks. And anything that he spends before this is not counted. So for instance, you know, I am sure of getting a ticket. I file my nomination tomorrow, and 2 weeks before I can spend crores of rupees, this is not counted into the 70 lakhs. This is another lacuna.
So it looks like flouting the rules is very common. For example, voter bribing, it's an open secret in our country. What is the Election Commission doing about this? Are there any penalties imposed or any rules?
You know, while the Election Commission has set a stellar example of conducting free and fair elections across the country, you know, through the tumultuous times in between 1970s and 90s, they have done a fair job of conducting elections. But when it comes to enforcing regulations, you know, they have not stamped their authority. For instance, they can only implement the current rules. And ultimately, these rules are made by elected representatives who sit in the parliament. So the Election Commission has been found wanting in this space. Only when there are blatant violations, they have taken action. So for instance, there have been cases of disqualification when there is, you know, blatant misreporting of expenditure or rampant voter bribing, like what happened in Tamil Nadu, where the R.K. Nagar constituency, which was vacated by Jayalalitha's death, was countermanded or postponed twice, you know, because there is rampant voter bribing. Only in such blatant cases, the Election Commission does it. In all normal cases, you know, the Election Commission just issues notices, people respond to those notices, and the story ends there.
My goodness, looks like there are a lot of issues with election spending. Is it just our country, or is it the same across all democracies?
Yeah, there are best practices to learn from. Not that there's one country where everything is perfect, but there are best practices which we can learn from. For instance, in Japan and Germany, there are better disclosure norms. Things are transparent. Disclosure norms are better. Other norms are better. For instance, in Brazil and Philippines, corporate donations are banned. In US, most donations are disclosed. I mean, all the donations, there is no anonymity to funding. In Italy, Israel, and a few other countries, state funding was explored, where, you know, because of which a lot of new parties came into existence. Yeah, these are some best practices we could learn from and explore.
Okay. So to summarize, what do you think are the solutions to decrease election spending, get rid of black money, and to stop quid pro quo in our country?
Yeah, to summarize, you know, broadly, we can think of these things. The first one is transparency in political country, absolute transparency. Mm-hmm. No electoral bonds, no anonymity, you know, no disclosure if it is nothing like no disclosure if it is less than 20,000 and only disclosure if it is more than 20,000. Complete transparency is one. The second is there should be no anonymous funding. I mean, limits anonymous funding is a thing. We are saying no anonymous funding. And thirdly, there should be mandatory audits for all political party accounts like they do with any other company. You know, we can't just let political parties run with whatever funds and do no audits. Then I think we should also explore state funding. I mean, it's too early. We can't just go and implement it, but we can surely explore, do a couple of pilots, see how it's working. We should also expand the ECI's powers. For instance, today it is unable to stamp its authority on violations. I think time has come to look at reforms of the Election Commission's powers and rules. Then complete doing away with cash donations. I mean, the government wants to link everything with Aadhaar and say digital India. But, you know, believe me or not, for the electoral bond scheme, they don't want Aadhaar. So that's probably one of the only schemes where Aadhaar is not required. So we have to do away with cash donations, complete digital donations. And finally, and something that works all the time, there should be constant pressure from people like us, the civil society. And all these reforms in the system have only come through, you know, when civil society has acted and put pressure on the government. To summarize, I think there are four things that needs to be done. And these four things are these. One is we have to regulate funding. I mean, you can't have political parties get any kind of donations, any amount of donations and run with it. So we need to regulate funding. Secondly, we have to regulate expenses. Political parties cannot be allowed to spend as much as they want. Like we have a limit on candidates, we should have a limit on party expenses. Then we should mandate disclosures. In the sense, every rupee that is received by political parties should be disclosed. There is no question of anonymity of donors. Then punitive and other measures for violations should be very strict. I mean, today there are hardly any punitive measures, which is why political parties and candidates violate rules like they wish to. There should be strong punitive measures. Only if we do all this, I believe a better and corruption-free governance is possible.
Thank you so much for explaining. While that is at the policy level, I want to ask you, what is in the common person's hand? What can we do? And what about some people who are saying, take money from everybody and vote for whoever you want?
Yeah, we'll address that as well. I think there are multiple things that we can do as common citizens. One is get politically educated. See, when we say educated, we are not asking everybody to go and join politics. It's as simple as saying, know your candidate, engage with politicians, ask them, you know, where is transparency in funding? Where did you get this money from? These simple questions, engaging in politics is the first step. Secondly, you know, everybody makes a promise. Every party says, you know, we'll get rid of black money, you know, we'll usher in better governance, no corruption, etc. But only few of them actually take action. So it's time for us to question not just the parties, but also candidates, because candidates are people who at least once in a while interact with us. Then the least we can do, like we have been saying in all the episodes, people have to go out and vote. We all have to vote. And if, you know, I don't have a candidate of my choice is no reason, because there is always NOTA, you can express your displeasure. Then we should ask all the candidates their campaign expenses, how much are they spending, where are they spending, why are they spending. That's the only way, track their expenses. Then, like you said, you know, there is this whole norm, a lot of people say take money from every party and, you know, vote for the person you like. I think we are getting onto a dangerous slope there, because in a way we are encouraging candidates to give more and more. So tomorrow, if a candidate spends so much money and he knows that is not the necessary and sufficient condition to win, he'll be encouraged to spend more. And in a way, we are getting into a vicious cycle of people spending more, giving more bribes, and then getting into governance, earning more money. This is never going to stop. Just imagine if somebody is getting 5,000 rupees per vote, and if you calculate it per day for 5 years because the candidate is winning for 5 years, it is around 3 rupees per day, which is laughable. I mean, will somebody sell themselves for 3 rupees a day? So I think this has to stop somewhere.
Yeah. Thank you. So you heard it, friends. What we can do is know about our political parties, get more information, express our like or dislike by actually voting, whether it is for a candidate or for the NOTA option, and definitely say no to voter bribing. And together, let's make a promise.
My vote is not for sale.
That's it for today, folks. Thank you for tuning in for today's episode. If you like the video, please like, share, and subscribe. And don't forget to leave a comment for us.